Hey, this is Joe with Grow It, Build It, and today I'm going to tell you all about lanceleaf coreopsis. This is a perennial that's native to North America, mainly in the Midwest and Southeast United States. It likes to grow in full sun and well-draining soil. Another common name is sand coreopsis, so obviously it likes sandy soil, but I grow mine in everything in between, like clay to rocky stuff. It seems to grow about everywhere. As long as it drains well, it should be okay. But each plant will produce dozens and dozens of these beautiful yellow flowers that are, you know, they're really prominent on top of a slim stem. So it almost looks like they're floating sometimes. But if you put it in full sun and well-draining soil, this plant should get about 2 feet tall and about 2 feet wide at the top and at the base about a foot. So you can space them about a foot apart if you want to make a mass planting. I've actually done a little less. Now, we do have a very detailed article at our website, growitbuiltit.com, which I'll put a link to in the show notes if you want to get some more pictures and details about it. But overall, this is a really cool plant. I've never had any rabbit damage or deer damage on these, so they definitely appear to be deer and rabbit resistant to me. But it's so showy, though, you can actually make, like if you want to make cut flowers for your house, like put them in vases. You can make good bouquets out of this, or you can also mix them with other species. It's a really, it's a good flower to have around for that. Now, it's also a great flower for wildlife. This is heavily visited by bees and butterflies, mainly bees, but it's a nectar and a pollen source, so you're going to bring them all in. So mostly smaller bees are what I see more frequently, but you will get the occasional larger butterfly like this. I think that's a black swallowtail. And you know, also some bumblebees. And it's actually kind of neat when like a bumblebee lands on a tall one that's a kind of out in the open, because the whole flower head will start shaking, which is pretty neat. But this thing is going to produce a whole lot of blooms early on and be very showy in late spring to early summer. After that, it's going to put like sporadic blooms out. It's going to keep producing blooms all the way until frost, basically. I've actually looked at pictures I've taken of other ones, and you can still see them blooming in October. But I'll show you a trick to keep it looking nice longer, though. Now, as these blooms do start to fade, though, it starts to produce seed, and that's going to bring in other wildlife. You'll start to see birds landing on the flower heads to come eat the seeds and pick them out of there. Mainly I see goldfinches doing this. I'm sure there's probably some others, but definitely the goldfinches. And so it's kind of cool, like, you have a natural bird feeder in your yard with this. So not only are you attracting lots of insects, you get to watch, you know, birds go to town. Now, the birds doing this will contribute to this plant doing a little bit of self-seeding, which we'll see, but in a minute. But if you want to save seeds yourself, it's real easy. You just take a seed head that's turning brown, crush it in your hand, you'll get some seeds out. The birds had actually already been to this one, but they didn't get them all. So they make these, so these little paper discs are seeds. And you can store them in a cool dry place. Like, I've done it in a sealed container after drying them thoroughly and kept them in my basement. But to plant them from seed, it's pretty easy. You plant them just like milkweed. Basically put them in the surface of the soil. You can put a light dusting soil on top of them. I generally don't if I'm growing in pots. Then just water it in, and it needs a cold stratification period, or winter sow it. I'll put cards in the right for how I do winter sowing, and also this method, which is simulating a winter using the refrigerator. So if it's summertime and you want to grow these, you need to follow that method. This is what the seedling looks like after germination. It just got its first true set of leaves, and you know, it's pretty identifiable that way. But the seeds seem to be very viable. Like, I mean, here's two volunteers I had in my flower bed a little ways away from the plants, actually. And that they germinated this year. Now, this grows and establishes itself from seed very quickly. This is one of those seedlings a few weeks later after that last little clip. And you can see it's already got a bloom and it's producing another bud. So a lot of perennials will not bloom their first year, but this one will if you put it in conditions that it likes. Now, if you do happen to come across something early in spring before it's blooming, they're pretty easy to identify. They have kind of a three-pronged leaf with the middle prong being very long and slender. I think you'd call that, you know, trilobed with a deep lobe, but the margins are smooth. The leaf is smooth. There's no hairs on anything. But you won't have to wait that long because it's going to bloom in late spring, early summer, and it'll bloom right up through October. But the seed heads I showed you earlier are easy to identify as well. But these plants, though, they really do grow and establish quickly from seed. You know, most of what we're seeing here has been second year plants. Actually, like by the start of the second year of this plant, it should basically be full size. Now, let's talk about how we can keep these looking really bright and yellow for longer. We're going to deadhead those. Now, deadheading a flower is pretty easy. This one's no different from any others. You just find the spent flower head, follow the stalk down to a junction of leaves right there, and that's where you're going to cut it. You just have to do it to all of them, and if you do them all at once, you should encourage another mass round of blooming, which, you know, should overlap enough to make it look very showy. It doesn't take too long to deadhead one of these. I mean, 10-15 minutes or so. Frankly, I don't do it that often, or in the past I haven't because of time, but now that we've put a couple down here by our mailbox and light pole, and they're very obvious from the street, I'm going to try to keep these looking better. When I said these grow fast from seed, you're looking at one that's a second year plant. So, I mean, it's as big as it's going to get right away. But you can see this is less than a week after deadheading. I've got tons of new buds all getting ready to open up. So I should have, again, a very massive, a mass showy bloom period coming up. So it works, and I've, you know, it's really just a chore you just got to do periodically if you want to keep them looking good. Anyways, though, it should come back and start looking like this, which was probably a month ago. I think right around then. But I need to talk about something else with this plant. Depending on where you plant it, it may flop over. And so I want to talk about that. Now, you see how this is getting blown around from every direction by the wind, and it's upright. Same with this one. It's blown from every single direction, and nothing is flopping over. There's a reason for that. The wind is actually like strengthening the stalk. It's kind of like lifting weights for plants. It'll make it so they can support their flowers better. You contrast that with these are flopping over kind of towards the camera and to the right. Well, this plant's shielded by my house and my garage. So because of that, I've got to take some mitigating action to make it better. So what's our options? Well, let's look everywhere I have one of these plants. The first place I have one is in our little backyard prairie you see here. This is surrounded by many other plants, which help provide support. This doesn't need any kind of staking, and it's fine. It's also exposed to the wind. Now here at the light pole, again, it's completely exposed to the wind, and it's fine. Same with the mailbox. But here, if I don't do anything, half that sidewalk is going to be covered with flowers. The first year we grew them, it was very annoying and didn't look so nice. We tried staking them, and that didn't. I'm not a fan of staking. So what I'm doing here is I'm actually just giving this a haircut before it blooms. I'm cutting the stalks back by half. And doing this will make it so that these stalks can support the weight of their own flowers and provide support to the other ones. And this works pretty good. Now, they're still encroaching on the sidewalk, you know, despite my efforts, but it doesn't look, I mean, when I walk by, I don't think, man, I got to stake these plants. You know, it seems fine to me. So anyways, we can kind of recap this flower. So it's Lanceleaf Coreopsis. It's very showy, bright yellow blooms that'll last several weeks. You can prolong those blooming periods by deadheading the plant. And it likes full sun. It grows about 2 feet tall, which is 60 centimeters, and also about the same width at the top. You can pack them in very close together, though. It produces nectar and pollen, so it will bring all kinds of pollinators, all kinds of bees, butterflies. The only thing I've never seen on here is a hummingbird. Doesn't mean they don't visit it, but I've not noticed it. It's deer and rabbit resistant, and for soil types, you know, I've found it to grow about anywhere as long as it drains well. So, you know, dig a hole, fill it with water, you know, see if it drains or not. But it's really a great plant for wildlife. It's a really great plant for any kind of flower bed. And if you guys got any questions, just ask them in the comments and I'll do my best to answer them. And check out the website, the article on the website at growupbuilder.com. And if you guys have enjoyed this, give me a thumbs up and subscribe if you want to see more. Thank you so much.